Python decorators are very powerful and useful. Here is an example. I can use the add flower decorator to add a flower on top of a square. I can simply change the decorated function to add a flower to a triangle. And I can do the same thing for a star with minimal code change. Decorators behave like Lego blocks. I can create another decorator called timeMate to simultaneously add a flower to our shape and time how long it takes to do it. This is animated Python decorators. It's an intermediate level bite-sized tutorial. All you need to know is Python basic functions, basic classes, and some fundamental data structures. Here's the outline. I will talk about a classic cached decorator, but I will also show you how I solve my own problem when I created this very video. This video somehow becomes a meta tutorial. Let's first talk about the meaning of first class citizen in Python. Let's take string as example. We can assign a string to a variable and reassign it. We can also store strings in a data structure, for example, a list. Here I have a list, Python is great. I can append another string to it. I can also pass a string to a function and return another string from it. Everything we do here on a string, we can do the same thing on a function. Most importantly, we can pass a function to another function and get a new decorated function from it. A decorator is essentially a function that takes a function as argument and returns another function as output. Picture it as a coloring process. It takes a blue function and outputs a red one. Let me walk you through a concrete example. First, define the Fibonacci function, which utilizes recursion to calculate the ith Fibonacci number. This naive approach has no memory. In the example shown here, Fibonacci number 3 and Fibonacci number 2 are both calculated twice. We don't want this. The situation will get out of hand quickly. To solve this issue, we need cache. Let's define a function called cached, which takes our fib function and returns the cached version of it. Taking a closer look, we define a cache dictionary to store the calculated Fibonacci numbers earlier. If n is in the cache, just simply return the result. Otherwise, let's calculate it. But in the process of calculation, utilize the cache as well. Let's do a quick performance benchmark. Calculate Fibonacci number 30. The cached version is about hundreds of thousands times faster than the uncached version. Now the logic is clear. Let's focus on the syntax. Inside the cached function, we define a new function, the cached version of Fibonacci number calculation. Its logic measures what we just went through exactly, but what is args? And why is n the first element in args? Args stands for arguments. Specifically, it's a tuple of arguments. It's not a reserved word in Python, it's just a conventional variable name. Similarly, we have the kwargs, which stands for keyword arguments. It is a dictionary. The usage of these two are very similar, so now let's focus on the args. We can use a star sign to unpack an args. To the function, we'll see the elements in the args tuple just as regular positional arguments. Our fib function only has one argument, n. Therefore, args is just a one element tuple. Here, I print it out for you. Up to now, the variable names in the cached function are specific to the Fibonacci function. Let's transform it so it can be used for general function result caching. In this version, the args tuple is a dictionary key. Since tuple is immutable, so this is perfectly legal. Our cached function now is not limited to Fibonacci function. For example, now I'm applying it on the factorial function. The formal name of this caching strategy is called dynamic programming. It's one of the most important topics for tech interview. If you want to learn more about this, let me know in the comments. Next, we enter the most interesting part of this tutorial. I used Decorator to create this tutorial that talks about decorators. I used a Python library called Manon that the mighty 3 blue and brown created to create this video. Don't feel intimidated, it's actually pretty straightforward. What you see now is exactly the code that created this square. Line 5 creates the square and line 6 utilizes the self's play method to create the animation. That's basically the whole story. Don't feel intimidated. I'm here with you. I see myself utilizing Manon a lot in the future. What if I want to create thousands of squares? Here, for example 8, I can use a for loop that works. But what if I want to add more and more default customized behavior to my squares? For example, I want to shake it, add a flower, something like this. How about applying to these default creation animations to different kinds of objects? I don't want to create the same code again and again. I want to have a collection of decorations so I can build any Lego-like decorators I want. So this is exactly what I was thinking when I tried to solve this problem. I started writing my first decorator. First thing first, I turn this square creation into a function. This can also be done using class decorator, but that's too much and involves source code change. I'm happy with this simple encapsulation here. The real issue here is that where is our self argument? This is what's happening when we try to decorate a method from a class. The rectangle thing, the class, has a create square method, which has the self argument that refers to the class. And when we decorate it, the self still refers to the original class. This may be surprising to you, but self is not a Python keyword. It's just the conventional notation to refer to the class that a method belongs to. The problem is solved. With this shake decorator you are seeing on the screen, I can shake any object at the exact moment it is created. Decorators can be applied on top of each other. This is called nested decorators. Here, I apply 3 decorators to this triangle. It's rotated, flipped, then flipped again with respect to another axis. The order of decorators matter. You rotate it first, then flip it, or you flip it first, then rotate. The results are different, in general. As you may notice, the 2 decorators on the left has exactly the same result of the decorator on the right. So the decorators, including the identity do nothing decorator, actually form a group. Mathematical concept group. It has a name, D3. For more details about group and symmetry, check this video by 3 blue and brown that appears on the top right corner. Let's summarize what we have learned. Decorators are functions that take another function as input and return new function as output. The args and kw args are just the conventional names for positional and keyword arguments. You can use them to pass around the arguments. Lastly, decorators can be nested, but their orders matter. Pay attention. At the very end, I leave some questions and exercises for you. I look forward to discussing them with you in the comment section. See you next time.